This is a production of Cornell University.
So, our speaker today really needs no introduction, but we're going to give one anyhow, George. George is not a conventional scientist here, so we'll give a little unconventional introduction. And what I'd like to share with you, he's actually giving his own autobiography today, entitled 40 Years and 40 Minutes. But what I thought we'd do to kind of get the thing started is read some excerpt stanzas from a wonderful poem some of your peers wrote for your retirement dinner not so long ago. And I won't read the whole thing, but this was put together by a number of colleagues, including Sandra Jensen, Don Daly O'Brien, Sean Keneally, and others. So here we go, George, an ode to George Hudler. On a bright, sunny day, a young man from Cloquet through a microscope did peer. He had found his career. A world full of fungi was just right for this fun guy. With studies completed after a spell, he was off to a job, a career at Cornell. For pests of shrubs and trees, he's our specialist in disease. Of that, there's surely no doubt, this co-editor of Branching Out. Three courses he's taught over the years, and short courses with various peers. For his teaching style, we must say this is a treat future students will miss. After 20 plus years teaching mushrooms so magical, George may have seemed somewhat fanatical. While planning this year-end final feast, that was a tribute to mushrooms and yeast. So this man who came from Minnesota, who said plant disease makes my mouth water, has taught us that mushrooms are magic and that toadstools can sometimes be tragic. But you might not be aware, 'twas while George was plant pack chair that cheers with your peers first brought us Thursday beers. George Hudler has often been here to take part in departmental cheer. He has encouraged camaraderie and shared much hilarity. And a few years after retiring, when fishing and golf ceased to be firing, of neurons so used to mental exercise, it might not come as a surprise if George might just start to hanker to see some lethal bleeding beach canker, or wish he could find some inoculum of that Vitisma Americana. George has received awards aplenty for both education and arborist society. Excellent in teaching has marked his career. We're so glad that he chose to teach here. But after an illustrious career that concludes in his 39th year, we might hope he'd stay just one more and make it an even 2 score. And I think we're getting our wish, because if I'm not mistaken, this marks into your 40th season at Cornell. So with no further ado, George Hudler.
Okay, now I gotta turn on number 2 here. Okay. Well, thanks to you all for coming. This is really a treat for me. I didn't realize that this might actually come to pass, an exit seminar, but I've enjoyed the opportunity to put it together. I do have to start out with a disclaimer. When I gave the title to somebody, I said 40 years and 40 minutes, but it's more like it's going to be closer to 40 years and 50 minutes, so you might as well settle in. Now, I got to tell you that what I didn't expect when I started to put all this together was how much it was going to cost me. You see, when you're retired, you get a free N parking permit, and that gives you the right to park in these flex zones down by the loading dock for 2 hours. And what happened to me in the last several weeks is I got so preoccupied with all of the stuff that I had to go through and enjoying every minute of it, I forgot the 2 hours. So here I am today, 14 days and 3 tickets and $90 later. That's about the only reason I'm glad this is over. So my career in plant pathology started at the University of Minnesota near the end of my junior year when I had to take a course in forest pathology. And I've told the details of that first day many times, and I'm not going to repeat it here, but to be sure, it marked a profound change in my life. In the short space of 48 hours, I went from a very young man with no real aspirations to a life with a new awareness of the potential of biology to provide important answers to important questions that needed answers right now. And it gave a purpose to my life. The person who started it all was Dave French. He taught that forest pathology course, and he lit a fire under me. He not only took me under his wing, but he did so with a subtle but very clear message that he had confidence that I could succeed. And at that time in my life, I really needed that. He was the product of a colorful line of plant pathologists, including Clyde Christensen, who wrote the book, The Molds and Man. And knowing what has happened to me over the years, he won't be surprised to learn that Clyde had an important role. And then there was E.C. Stakeman, a contemporary of H.H. Wetzel and the most solid pillar in the foundation of our discipline. Stakeman was 88 the last time I gave a seminar in our department. And on seminar day, as the clock moved agonizingly slowly toward the 4 p.m. start time, I, as all other graduate students, would have one eye on the back door, where Stakeman would appear like Moses on the Mount if he was going to be there that day. And if he did, he'd take up a seat near the front of the lecture room, pipe dangling from his mouth, his head nodded as if enjoying an afternoon nap. And then near the end of the talk, just when you thought the job was done, Stakeman would stir. He'd open his eyes and he'd start to ask questions that might last for another hour or so. No one dared to leave. And the poor student in the front of the room had an abbreviated but very public A exam as Stakeman probed every nook and cranny of that seminar topic. It was an incredibly character-building experience, and I never even began to appreciate at the time how it would influence me over the years to come. But it does make me shiver to recount the tale now. So learning in the company of those three men and my fellow graduate students at Minnesota just brought a breath of fresh air to my academic life. Together with my colleagues, we all just came to enjoy learning more and teaching each other, and it was a wonderful time. In fact, I even began to think I might have the wherewithal to become a productive thinker at some point in time, and I'm not quite sure I've reached this stature yet. But much as I loved Minnesota, and especially the rich plant pathological history, the early 70s was a time for people my age to see the world. So I chose to land at Colorado State University, and I was there to continue my studies under the direction of Frank Hawksworth, an icon in his own right for his foundational research on a group of plant parasitic plants called dwarf mistletoes. Among other things, mistletoes had a very unique seed dispersal mechanism. Pressure would build up in ripe berries, each berry containing a single seed, and when the pressure was relieved, the seeds would squirt out of there at speeds over 60 miles an hour, and they would easily travel 20 meters or more through the air, hoping to land on another susceptible tree. My job was to determine whether or not birds could be important vectors for reintroducing the sticky seeds of the pathogen to areas that had been clear-cut to eradicate the original infestation. 3 years and the examination of literally hundreds of birds and thousands of bird droppings, I concluded that their role in spreading the disease was pretty small, definitely not worth enough concern to change management practices. And to this day, eradication is still the most successful approach to this really very serious group of plant diseases. But in terms of life lessons, and I'm going to intersperse periodically here with life lessons, One was, for me, was that confidence grows confidence. It was that confidence that Dave French expressed in me that made me more confident in myself. And that experience just resonated time and time again. And I vowed at the time that whenever I had an opportunity to work with students as well, I would do my best not to just dictate what they do, but to try to convey confidence that I had that they could do it. And it was an important thing for me. Second of all, that teachers are at their best when they're teaching from personal experience. And boy, I saw this in spades. Once it kind of dawned on me, I watched various professors teaching things. When they were teaching from the book, when they were teaching from papers that somebody else wrote, it was one, there was one layer of enthusiasm, whatever. But when they got to what they were doing, it just ratcheted up completely. And the whole, it electrified the classroom every time. And I vowed then as well to try to put together as many of my own stories as I could possibly could. Pictures really are worth a thousand years. I wasn't much of a photographer, but as I began to approach this new to me science of plant pathology, it was obvious that if I was going to share my message with people who weren't familiar with it, it would be so much more effective to do it with pictures. And so I started taking pictures, and now I've got thousands, and I'm not sure what I'm going to do with them. And then finally, growing old doesn't have to mean growing stale. And my example of that was Clyde Christensen. When I met him, he was in his mid-70s. He'd been retired about 10, 12 years. But he showed up at the plant pathology department every morning, Monday through Sunday, 8 o'clock, with a bounce in his step, a twinkle in his eye. You thought you were seeing a little kid coming downstairs to a new Christmas tree. He zoomed off to his lab, puttered away there the rest of the day, and came out the other side. And when I watched all that unfold, I thought, you know, George, maybe getting old isn't going to be so bad. Well, then I saw an advertisement as I was finishing up at Cornell, or in Colorado, for a job out in a place called Cornell in New York. And I got on the plane and fully expected that when I opened the window as we got closer, this is what I was going to see. And that's just to give you an indication of how little I knew of what was going on east of the Mississippi River. But so I was pleasantly surprised to, in fact, find this instead. And with the water and the trees and the kinds of things that were so familiar to my life in Minnesota, that I figured that this was a place that I could make home, and I obviously have. Among other things, I was taken under the wing of this man, Wayne Sinclair, who was an incredible mentor for me at the time and has proven to be that, and an important advisor even today, as well as a very good friend. And I'm kind of embarrassed that this is the best picture I have of Wayne in my collection, but on retrospect I thought, well, maybe it isn't so bad, because I can't count the number of times he kept me from going off the deep end. And so maybe this was all right. I also came conveniently, there was a raging epidemic of a disease called scleroderis canker going on in conifer forests up in the Adirondacks. And so I was able to get some funding to begin research on this. The disease itself, it was affected both forest trees, but more importantly for my purposes, Christmas trees, which were part of my responsibilities. It caused a twig blight, and in and of itself, we wouldn't worry too much about that, except that when an inoculum from one twig would then go to others and others and others, and it quickly snowballed until all the twigs were killed, and with all the growing points killed, then trees began to die, and they died by the thousands. And this was quite alarming. People were concerned about just what was going on there, what might happen, and in particular, what would happen if the disease got out of the current range, its current range, which was in the Adirondack region, especially on cut Christmas trees. What if it were spread to other conifer forests in other parts of the country? And so they imported, set up a quarantine measure, and my graduate student and I at the time were set with trying to figure out just how big and how realistic the threat really was. And by the time all was said and done, we had kind of concluded that for a number of different reasons related to climate, related to inoculum load and other things, that this probably wasn't the threat that it was originally perceived to be. And when we reached that conclusion, others did as well. The money dried up, and we moved on to other things. In fact, yeah. So that was kind of thing. Now the odd thing was that when people quit paying attention to scleroderis, it just went away all by itself. And even today, nobody knows why. If I were going to try to show students a sample of scleroderis canker, I could go up to the old spots we used to work on, and I know I can't find one damn branch that's infected. So why? Like I say, we just don't know. We can't take any credit for it, although given the chance, we probably would. But what were the life lessons? Well, here you go. Ecosystems can be inexplicably resilient. And once in a while, if you just let them go, they'll take care of themselves. I don't think you can do this all the time. You can't count on it, but it does happen. The other thing is that good science can sometimes defy replication. One of the things we needed to do was produce a lot of inoculum. And we tried and tried and tried to get our pathogen to produce spores in culture, and that damn thing just would not cooperate. And then one day, one of Bill Fry's postdocs wandered down the hall, and he said, well, we're using this concoction down there to grow P. infestans. Why don't you throw some VH juice and some other stuff in there and give it a try? So we did. And by the end of the week, we had spores flying out of our petri dishes. It was the most incredible thing in the world. And for the next 2 years, we had all the spores we could possibly need. We were able to conduct some very interesting experiments and get done what we needed to get done. But toward the end, thank God, we were almost done because our incubator died. And it was one of these tabletop incubators. So I said, there are others kicking around the apartment. They're not being used. Let's just crank one up. We'll go on. So we did. And we had the same temperature, the same photo period, near as we could tell, the same light intensity. And those cultures would not reproduce one damn spore. And it continued like that. The only reason I mention this is that I have no reservation whatsoever, no loss of confidence in the work we did and the work we published. But if somebody today was to take our methods and try to do it, it probably wouldn't work. And part of the reason that I bring this up now is that right now you may or not be aware that there's an effort to reproduce a half dozen or so critical experiments in cancer research. And the two of the first three have failed. And how easy it is for people to point to the researchers and say, aha, we can't replicate your efforts, so your work must not be any good. Well, I'd be a little reluctant to jump on that bandwagon yet, because there are these subtle things. I don't know if anybody who's here from Geneva, but I think Wayne Sinclair had a student who had the same deal, didn't he? They was trying to produce spores of something, and one day the student, I don't remember how it went, but he ran up the stairs in Barton Hall and then ran back down and put the plates back on the table, and they sporulated and nothing. So weird things happen, and I just am really, makes me more nervous than ever to think we would just write off things because they can't be immediately replicated. Then the other thing, of course, is that when interacting with the press, you got to choose every word with enormous care. And if you have any chance, write it rather than say it. And especially with the interest in Christmas trees and people frantic about what was going to happen to the trees and the presents underneath and all this other, this fungus that was on there. And I had some radio interviews and some newspaper articles written after phone calls. And boy, what I thought I said and what I read later that day or heard on the news later that night, in fact, even the CBS Evening News one night, I just shuddered. And I still had a lot of interaction with the press, but boy, I tread very, very lightly. Meanwhile, while the Christmas tree growers were interested in my activities and everything, there's another audience down in southeast New York that had enormous concern with my work. Interest in my work because my job included extension on woody ornamentals of all kinds of plants. And I'll tell you, down in southeast New York, in the metropolitan New York area and the counties around there, tree care and plant health care management is incredibly lucrative. It's also incredibly competitive, almost to a level of stories that you might hear in The Godfather. And furthermore, the guys that are involved, the people that are involved in that, are very, very smart, and they're very well connected with the political establishment in New York State. So when you go to work with them, they have no time for idle speculation or random BS. They want answers to their questions right now, or they want assurance that you'll come up with those answers in short order. And the kind of the carrot, or if you call it that, maybe the stick at the end of the carrot was that, you know, if they became dissatisfied with the service they got, it might find its way back to the state legislature. So I kind of, it was an enormous challenge for me as a little hick guy from the middle America to come in and immerse myself in this audience. But I managed to make it work. And today, some of the best friends I have in the arboricultural industry are in that part of the state. And it was just really good. In fact, I reflect back and I gotta think that whoever wrote, "If you can make it there, you'll make it anywhere," they must have started out like I did from someplace else, because it was quite a deal. The life lessons, though, in terms of this emphasis on extension, is that for me, standalone extension work can be rewarding. I got to share information that people really needed to know. I was challenged to provide answers to problems on the fly. Thanks, Stakeman. I had to sharpen my own analytical skills on the fly. Thanks, French. You learn from people who see your patients every hour of every day. They might not have the academic background you have, but they have experience in spades. And when you put those two things together, I think that they pay off in all kinds of ways. Extension audience, now here's the liability for me. Extension audiences are very content in most cases if you just tell them what it is and how to fix it. And for me, that got to be an intellectual liability. I was actually applauded for the good advice I gave, and I kind of seduced by this warm feeling. But it wasn't until I took on some new responsibilities, teaching Plant Path 443, Pathology and Entomology of Trees and Shrubs. This was a collaborative effort with a fellow in entomology. But it was here, picking up a course that Wayne Sinclair had taught, where he had taken, purposely took his students well beyond just what is it and how to fix it. He wanted them to know why. And in, among other things, I think he wanted them, because they were paying a good amount of money and they were intellectually capable, he wanted them to stretch their imagination and know why things were going on. And I picked up that. I using Wayne's foundation, I was able to pick this up. And I found myself wanting to be able to answer those same questions in my own way. And so I spent a lot of hours here with the wee hours of the morning putting together presentations, not just lectures, but visuals as well, that would help me to do that. And I could just sense myself then growing in the process. Eventually, that why and answering those questions then began to filter back to my extension audiences in such a way that they then, and they began to appreciate that, at least I'm sure they did, and I swear today, or even as that grew, that they became more inquisitive. They actually became more challenging to me, but I think they became more effective in the field because now they also had been stretched beyond that limit. So teaching challenged me. Now, there were a number of topics that I wasn't, even though I was supposed to be a tree pathologist, a number of topics that I had to learn to be fluent with, kind of on the fly. And I was always on the lookout for these personal experiences that I could use as springboards to convey my message. and then just maybe to expose new paradigm shifts that could lead to new discoveries. And I don't have time to develop that today. But let me tell you one other thing that I'm kind of getting off my script here. I hadn't planned to do that. But one of the other things is that that at the time I was teaching, a good proportion of the students who took this course had gotten the first 2 years of their college at a community college or a state school somewhere else in the state, and then they came to Cornell. So they transferred in. And they didn't have the basic biology and even basic botany that students who started at Cornell might have. And so I had to find a way to kind of bring them up to speed without slowing the rest of the class down, but also in a way that didn't single them out as deficient. And so it was a bit of a challenge, but I did it. And at the end of the day, I don't think anybody really even knew the difference, because I kind of snuck it in. But everybody in relatively short order could move to intellectually forward then as a cohesive group. And I was actually pretty proud of the way that all worked out. Okay, now I do have to get to my script, because one extension trip took me, in 1980 I went down to Rockland County to talk to the Rockland County Arborist Association, the evening talk. And the title of my talk was Tree Diseases, Review and Preview. And I tell you, I gave a lot of talks with that title. They were all different, but it was such a convenient talk. Okay. So anyway, so the association secretary, who had a bit of a reputation for matching each page of minutes with a stout martini, recorded the events this way. He said, the speaker spoke. Our guest, speaking on diseases of woody plants and how to cure them, gave a seemingly erudite talk in a splendid manner. He's really a charming young man. Only time will tell whether or not he's full of shit. And so I was done. I opened the floor to questions, and it was as if people never heard a word I said. All they wanted to talk about was what's wrong with the dogwoods. This picture shows snow on the hillside. Actually, I had come down from Ithaca. We still had snow up there. But the dogwoods were blooming down in the southeast New York. And all I could say at the time was, I don't have any idea. I don't even know what you're talking about. But I'll stay on for another day or two, and we can look around and see what we find. And sure enough, something unusual was happening with flowering dogwoods in landscapes and in adjacent woodlands. They were dying, and there were a lot of them. The damage started out as leaf spots, then it kind of morphed into a twig blight, and finally into the death of entire trees. The problem seemed to be confined, do I have a pointer here? Yeah, to just a relatively small area in Westchester County and another area near Oyster Bay out on Long Island. Relatively small area. But in those areas, there were a lot of dead and dying dogwoods. And this was the spring. People count on, they're like robins, they count on those dogwoods, and when they're not there, it's painful. Well, I looked closely, as close as I could at the time. I brought samples back here. There was a fungus that a coelomycete of some sort producing minute pycnidia in even minuter, that's not a word, but I'm going to use it anyways, whatever was there looked like 100 other fungi that grow on the twigs of dogwoods. And so it wasn't immediately obvious to me that there was anything special about this. And I kind of took it all in, and I kind of, with a little bit with that scleroderis episode in my background, I thought, well, you know, I'm not sure what's happening, but I think it's kind of a confluence of environment or whatever, a little maybe inoculum, maybe some kind of a wave year of infection. And this happens now and then. We'll get an outbreak of some disease. It'll go for 1 year, and then it kind of subsides. I said, just relax. I think things will be okay. Well, I couldn't have been more wrong. Next year it covered there, and then it went right up the Hudson Valley, and then through the whole doggone state of New York. Upon closer examination by mycologists actually at Beltsville, they discovered that this disease they decided to call the disease dogwood anthracnose, and the pathogen was completely new to science, aptly named Discula destructiva. And these pictures were typical of dogwood anthracnose when I first ran into it, but now it occurs throughout the range of flowering dogwood. And as you might expect, there are a few survivors, And some entrepreneur spots those and chooses to propagate them. They're probably, in all intents and purposes, resistant. And that could be where the next generation comes. But for now, you'd be hard-pressed to buy a flowering dogwood from any commercial nursery in the eastern U.S. and maybe in the whole United States. Virtually everything looks like flowering dogwood, but it's actually a hybrid between Cornus florida and then an oriental dogwood that does have the resistance that's needed. And interestingly enough, I don't think anyone knows the difference except the people that are doing the making the hybrids. So the life lessons, well, first of all, you're never as damn smart as you think you are. But if you just admit it, people will respect your humility. And this was kind of an important crossroads for me. I obviously blew it. And if I had taken some other tack, I might have eroded confidence in that whole audience for a long time. But I kind of told a story just like I'm telling it to you. I did blow it. We didn't see it coming. By the time it became apparent, we also knew that the thing had spread like wildfire across the state. Even if there was a fungicide that might have been used, the horse was already well out of the barn. But the other thing, and just to reinforce that then, but by admitting that, and maybe even putting a little bit of levity, but serious levity into it, I think I was able to maintain the confidence of the group. But the other thing is that high levels of international traffic through New York State provides enormous potential for invasive species. You simply can't relax. When I taught plant disease diagnosis, I always told the students, I give them an unknown, and I say, now the first thing you do with this, don't culture it, don't run PCR, put the ELISA back in the drawer, pick up a damn book and read, what do we know about this plant and its problems? And the chances are 999 out of 1,000 that the answer is there. And at least when you start spending money and time on expensive tests, you'll have something, some firmer direction to go. So I say 999 out of 1,000. Well, now in New York State, I'm thinking more like 99 out of 1,000, because so much junk comes in, and you see this in the paper almost every month. Something new is coming in the door. So you can't relax in a place like this. So then, with the dogwood anthracnose story kind of in my back of my mind, these samples showed up on my desk. This is Norway maple with big black blotches on it, fungal growths. I looked at that and I said, you know, that looks like a disease I know on red and silver maple called tar spot. And I went to the books and by golly, they all said, yeah, tar spot occurs on Norway maple as well as these others. I thought, wait a minute. I've never seen this. If it's that common, we've had Norway maples in this country for hundreds of years. Why haven't we seen it before? But I accepted what I read. I wrote to the extension agent. I said, yeah, this turns out to be tar spot caused by Rhytisma acerinum. And don't worry about it. I said, you know, it's photogenic. It's a great classroom specimen, but it doesn't do any damage whatsoever to trees. So don't worry about it. Well, then about a month later, I got a call from this guy, George. Remember that sample I sent? Oh, yeah, geez, thanks a lot. Remember you said it wasn't going to cause any problem? Yeah. He said, well, maybe you ought to come out here and see the problem it isn't causing. Well, I got in the car and I went up there, and it looked like somebody had driven down the streets of that town with a flamethrower and fried every Norway maple from top to bottom. And that caused me to think, well, George, maybe you goofed again. So I began to take a closer look at it. We followed this over the course of a year. Those spots on the Norway maple would lay on the ground all winter. Then in the spring, they would open up, split open, little fissures, and out would come ascospores like little javelins, fly up in the air just at the time when the new Norway maple leaves are coming out. Infection would occur. Some years it would be worse than others. And when it was bad, it was bad. And pictures like this were common. But they only happened about once every 6 or 7 years when all the weather conditions, inoculum load, and others came together. We even had a glorious outbreak right here in Ithaca, New York, and you wouldn't believe the most chemophobic people in town were calling me up wondering, what can we spray to save our trees? Of course, there are other people in horticulture who say, if it's Norway maple, let it go. But anyway, that's another story. In the meantime, we hooked up with a fellow out at the U.S. Forest Products Lab in Madison and concluded that, in fact, This fungus on Norway maple was not the same one on red maple, but interestingly enough, the fungus on Norway maple, described by Fries hundreds of years ago, was the real Rhytisma acerinum. And the one on red maple and silver maple that we thought we knew well was a different fungus previously undescribed in the scientific literature. And so we did describe it, and we ended up calling it Rhytisma americanum because it did seem to be somewhat unique to the North American continent. Now, some people said, George, you blew it. Why didn't you call it Rhytisma hudleri and get your name in the literature? But I was drawn back to a story Dave French used to tell about a colleague of his named Professor Weir. And Professor Weir had a graduate student working on a wood decay fungus, new to science. And in honor of his professor, he named it Polyporus weirianus. And I thought, no, I'm probably better off not getting into the... So I stuck with americanum. And actually, you know, there were people who said this is decries the American America, and it's not a good idea, but I stick with it anyway. So the life lessons, see, I told you you weren't so damn smart. But the other thing is that respect previous work, but don't trust it to override gut instincts. And I think no matter what the literature says, it's a good place to start thinking about new things, but don't let it necessarily dictate. I mean, and then see a teachable moment for what it is. In the process of trying to get people to settle down about this tar spot, and for sure to prevent them or discourage them from getting up and driving down the street spraying fungicide 60 feet into the air, up one street and down the other, I tried to describe how, in fact, this disease was not that big a deal. It looked bad, but it had little or no impact on tree survival or health, because the damage was so late in the growing season that the tree could cope with all that, and it just didn't make a big difference. But I also then would go on to say, you know, it's like a lot of other leaf diseases, like apple scab and powdery mildew and the anthracnose and a few others. And it kind of through the back door, I was telling the public at large and the industry that a lot of these leaf diseases that you're controlling really probably don't need to be controlled. Now, if I had come out and said that straight away, the guys in the industry said, what are you trying to do? We're going to go broke if we don't have a chance to spray. But kind of sneaking through the back door this way seemed to pay off. Okay, let me move on. I got to keep moving here. The last episode in instance I want to show is our work with European beech. This is a majestic tree, of course, native in Europe and planted in the U.S. back, or started in North America back in the mid-1800s, but there was a big flurry between 1870 and 1900 when a lot of these trees were planted. Majestic trees, large crowns, branching, just made them really desirable, especially at places like aristocratic mansions and cemeteries, parks, college campuses is where they first showed up. And they were so popular, they continue to be planted a lot up to this day, but there is this large cohort of trees that's between 100 and 150 years old. Okay, among other things, in addition to just being valuable and the death of these trees on the landscape was sad for people who loved their trees, the other thing is that these sometimes had enormous impact on property values. Now, this estate, this house, which is a one-family home on Long Island, had four European beech. You see two of them here. This is in the backyard, and then there were two on the other side. And a real estate appraiser in that area told me, and I have no reason to doubt this, that if those four trees died, the value of this property would be reduced by $6 million. Four European beech trees. Why? Because collectively they framed this view of the New York City skyline. And so with them gone, all of a sudden that would open us up and change things completely. Well, I don't know how reliable, maybe that guy overestimated, but even if it was half that much, it was a tremendous impact. The problem is that I would get these phone calls from people who, you gotta come, my European beech tree is dying. And this began almost from the first year I was here, continued periodically along the line. Every time I got there, the trees were almost dead. The bark was falling off, there were saprobic fungi, there were insects, there was wood rotters, it was a mess. And there was nothing I could do but kind of say the last rites. And it was kind of discouraging. But there was nothing else I could do or think to do. And then one day I was at this place. This is a tree that was of concern. You can see the left half is pretty well dead. The right half looks better. But in fact, this is all one tree. And when you got to the bottom, the bark was falling off. There was just a little strip of live bark that was carrying any one amount of water and nutrients from the roots to the shoots and carbohydrates the other way. So I just kind of, this is another one. I don't know what to do. And I kind of, as I was putzing around there, I walked over. I noticed that there was this copse of trees on the backyard that were in some state of decline. Some looked pretty good. This is actually, I think, three or four trees altogether. But I just wandered over there for the heck of it, and I looked at the base of the trees, and I found this thing, which we know in the tree world as a bleeding canker. And we also know that sometimes these are caused by Phytophthora. Now, so for whatever reason, this was total serendipity. I happened to have an electric drill in my trunk, and I happened to have a brand new test kit for diagnosing Phytophthora in the field with ELISA technology. So I got out the drill. I didn't have any alcohol to sterilize it, but I did have a bottle of gin in the car. So I sterilized the drill. I drilled into the tree. I caught the shavings that came out on aluminum foil that also was sterilized with the gin. And then I ran it through this ELISA test, and wouldn't you know, it turned out positive. There's the positive and negative control. It turned out positive. And that observation all by itself launched a research program that went on for the next 7 or 8 years as we learned more and more about this. I got to run through this. One of the things is that once we knew to look for those bleeding cankers, irrespective of what was going on in the crown, to look for those bleeding cankers, we found out this was far more prevalent than we'd ever imagined. And between 25 and 40% of the trees have symptoms. In fact, we've got one right out here in Min's Gardens. I didn't put it there, but I'm glad I'm retired and don't have to take responsibility for it. Anyways, it's an extremely common thing, especially among this 100 to 150-year-old cohort. And I think that all of this has a bit to do with just flat-out old age. We originally concluded that the pathogen might be Phytophthora citricula, but then we learned Phytophthora citricula was a complex. There were other people in the world working on it. And eventually, our primary pathogen turned out to be Phytophthora pinei, which was an obscure Phytophthora isolated from the roots of some pine tree in northern Minnesota. And it kind of just drifted off into the hinterlands. But now with DNA sequencing and the like, this turned out to be our major pathogen. But we also had P. cactorum, Cambivora, and Gonopodides. But still, pinei was the primary pathogen. But clearly, there were other Phytophthoras involved. So the thing is, we isolated the pathogen. We isolated the pathogen, and we got, we had this all going, but we never actually proved Cox positives. Now, what are you going to do? How many people are standing around saying, "Oh yeah, come and inoculate my elegant tree for the sake of science"? You know, nobody's going to do that. And then one day, I learned some friend of mine had looked at the campus master plan. He said, "Hey, this tree down by Rockefeller, down the hill below Rockefeller Hall, this is going to be taking that out as part of the development of the new physical science building. Maybe you can work on that one." So I gave the grounds crew a call, and the guy assistant manager says, "Oh, you don't want to touch that. That thing was planted in honor of the class of 1961 or something like that." He says, "You don't want to get a bunch of alumni mad at you." I said, "Oh, okay, that's too bad." Then about a month later, I ran into the director of the grounds crew. And I came up, we were at another function. I came up behind him. I said, "Hey, Dennis." He turned around he says, "George, I'm so sorry I didn't answer that email. That tree's going to go anytime. You can inoculate, you can do whatever you want to it. Just," and I came back, I called Jerry Whalen, my postdoc. He had spore suspensions ready. We went down there, we drilled holes, we put more dams up Phytophthora in that tree than you could shake a stick at. And then on the way back up, we're walking up, and we're about halfway back to Plant Science Building. I said, "You know what, Jerry, the funny thing is, Dennis said we could even transplant that thing if we wanted to." And Dennis went, "There's Jerry." He was on my left shoulder, or right shoulder. I remember he stopped in. I turned in white as a sheet. He said, "Oh, my God. I've been talking to the grounds crew, true, and we just inoculated the wrong tree." And I thought, well, we could go back and put alcohol in the holes, but I was feeling kind of feeling kind of punchy, and I thought, let's just let it go. But for the next 2.5 years, I drove by. I said, oh, please don't die. Please don't die. Please don't die. And then one splendid morning, I came on campus, and here was the tree. The construction was about ready to start. The tree had been cut. The stump was there. I called Jerry again. We came down with mallets and chisels, and we stripped all the bark off that thing. And wouldn't you know, every infection site was deader than a doornail. We isolated the same fungus that we put in on each one of the root flares. And as far as I was concerned, we had a real pathogen. And Professor Koch wouldn't probably quite approve of that, but it made me okay. All right. In the meantime, we learned from colleagues in the out west who were working on another phytophthora that these phosphonate fungicides might prove to help control this thing. And while it didn't work that well for them, it worked incredibly well for us. And this has become standard procedure for treating these trees. And we've prolonged the lives literally of thousands of beech trees in the Northeast with this treatment. So the life lesson is, well, just keep plugging away. If your logic is sound and you just keep your eyes open, sometimes dumb luck will save you. And then the other thing else, with nothing to lose, cut to the chase. And when I say this, when we decided to start using this fungicide, we could have spent another decade trying to unravel all the intricacies of the biology. But I didn't want to wait 10 years while people's trees are dying hand over fist. So we went ahead with this fungicide, and it just happened to work. Now, I don't have time to tell some of the hairy sides of that story, but I do say do this all carefully. Okay, so some of you are probably wondering, Jesus, the thing is almost over and he hasn't said anything about the magical mushroom course yet. Well, that's because I'm not going to. It's because that's a story in and of itself. But the groundwork for that story was laid with all these life lessons. I learned how to communicate with various audiences. I took pictures. I knew the value of personal stories. All the parts came together. I learned to think on my feet, and so it was all there. And when it finally came time for me to begin to put that course together, I could hit the ground running. I certainly had to work my tail off to catch up on a number of topics that I didn't know much about, but I could do so with confidence. And so that's the only thing that made the biggest difference, though, was I had an incredible array of graduate students and staff members to help with it all. And if I have one big regret, it's that every year I didn't get my TAs together and take a picture, because even today I was trying to remember who was involved. And as I looked at pictures, these are a few of the key people, but you recognize the white hat in the center because she's taken over now. Now I got to, as I wrap this up, I got to cut to my script, because as I move to conclusion, I want to speak directly now to the undergrads and graduate students, postdocs, because you're the people who are going to shape the future of science and science education for the next generation. And with children and grandchildren of my own who are going to be on the receiving end of that education, I'm concerned about what's going to happen. At issue for me is that the scientific community just doesn't seem to be doing the job it needs to do to teach people who aren't part of that community what they are doing and why. Confidence in science and scientists seems, in my mind, to be falling a little too quickly and perhaps dangerously low levels among too much of the general public. I'm not sure what the ultimate consequences of all this will be. But I do think it's worthwhile to see the problem and to be thinking about these things with an eye toward turning the tide. Let me give you a couple of examples of what the public sees in the way of science. For years, guidelines for healthy blood pressure levels gleaned from study after study after study is that if you have hypertension, you should be shooting for 140 over 90. But in the last year or so, a meta-analysis of data from all these studies that arrived at this other conclusion has now caused doctors or scientists to say, medical professionals say, that the target should be 120 over 80. Imagine the frustration of hypertension patients they must be experiencing as they learn that the goal they worked so hard for is now all for naught. With the stroke of a pen, And even if they tried to get clarification, I can tell you, there's not one physician in 1,000 has a faintest damned idea what a meta-analysis is. And so they're in no position to explain it. They just kind of go along with the flow. And so I'm not surprised at the frustration that might, with other things as well, like recommendations for getting mammograms, like the safety of artificial sweeteners, like the value of PSA levels for predicting prostate cancer, and myriad other guidelines. The scientific community in the public eye just can't seem to make their eye up, mind up. And here's another example. How many of you know why Pluto is not a planet? Huh? Okay, I looked that up last week. I tried to figure out, why isn't it a planet? And almost everything I read focused more on the scientific community patting themselves on the back for making the declaration than for explaining why. In fact, I was stunned to see this picture as part of a video. This is a frame off of a video that is advertised as a clear and concise description of how a scientific community arrived, what the data is. You know what this is a picture of? This is a picture of some of the most prominent astronomers in the world in 2006, holding yellow pieces of paper up in the air at the 26th General Assembly of the International Astronomical Society. And you know what they're doing? They're voting on the definition of a planet. In 2006, scientists have sent telescopes to the far reaches of the galaxy, put thousands of satellites in orbit, sent men to the moon, and taught millions of eager young minds about the excitement of science, and they still can't figure out what a planet is. And this vote didn't seal the deal. In my same search, I found some newer articles, and new, like 16 hours old, that there's a prominent group of people that want a recount. They want to do this again because they're not convinced. Now look, you and I know that one of the casualties of scientific inquiry is that new knowledge displaces the old, and with it, paradigms change. But if we don't do a better job of explaining that to more people who don't understand the process, then I think we leave ourselves open to mistrust, ridicule, and humiliation. One solution seems to be to appeal to the scientific community is to teach people to think like a scientist. But is that enough? I don't think so. I think by a long shot. I think what has much greater promise is to teach scientists to talk to that increasingly large portion of our population who have seen snippets of controversies debated in the social media. They've been swayed by irrational but elegant rhetoric. And they're often on the short end of the economic stick, but they're looking for anybody and anything to blame their problems on. And I fervently hope that some of you in this room will accept the challenge to reach out to those skeptics on their terms with the same enthusiasm and creativity that you bring to your science. But you got to do it with compassion, you got to do it with humility, and anything else it'll take to begin to restore that confidence that people used to have in the academy. Now I got one last thing to say. I got to take a glass of water here first. And then I'll shut up. And that is that if hearing my plea causes you to say to yourself, oh, he means we have to do a better job of dumbing it down, then you are not the person to speak for the academy. That phrase is demeaning. It's counterproductive in every possible way. And it's so subjective that I can't believe it comes out of the minds, mouths of the same people who pride themselves on the objectivity of their profession. In fact, every time I hear that phrase, I picture the speaker standing out in the field with a shovel in their hand, pushing down on that spade to dig the hole they're already standing in deeper so that they'll never get out of it. One way or another, I think we can do better. And if that phrase is in your lexicon, then I implore you to just plain stop it. If you need a catchy phrase to keep your juices flowing, try this one instead. You'll be happier, I'll be happier, and we'll all have a far better chance of making the lives of future generations better. And I'm done. Thank you very much.
This has been a production of Cornell University, on the web at cornell.edu.